Former cult members of Reddit, at what moment did you go, oh frick, I'm in a cult? Watching my grandma, who is the matriarch of my extended family and our family's glue, struggle to pay tithes and offerings every week, regardless of how much of a difference it would have made to her versus our rather large church. My grandma paid for her meds and change on a Monday, and while I watched our preacher get into a brand new, black and chrome Yukon Denali the Sunday prior, and it didn't make sense. Then, within the hearing of all the people, he said to his disciples, be on guard against the scribes, who like to go around in long robes and love greetings in marketplaces, seats of honor in synagogues, and places of honor at banquets. They devour the houses of widows and, as a pretext, recite lengthy prayers. They will receive a very severe condemnation. Luke 20 45-47. When they said I'm going to marry someone from Korea, when I said no, they said they already bought the plane tickets. You're going to marry a nice Korean person. Number. Come on, we already bought the plane tickets. In that case, have fun on your Korean vacation. One of the leaders said that we shouldn't watch any TV or read any material that wasn't published by the church. I said, well, I just like Road and Track magazine. I don't think that's anti-religious. He replied, that material will cause you to lust after material things and you shouldn't read that. It was at that point I knew I had to get the heck out of there. I mean, he was right. I currently have lots of broken car parts and no money. Parents joined the Jehovah's Witnesses for a few years when I was a kid. One Saturday, I stayed the night at a friend's house and went to church with them on Sunday. Minister at my friend's church talked about the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit. I was confused. Next Sunday at the Kingdom Hall, I asked our minister about it after services. He said, I don't know what you're talking about. Even at 11 years old, I knew he was lying. If he'd simply said that's a concept that we don't believe in, I wouldn't have lost respect in him, nor would have decided that everything coming out of his mouth was suspect. But I did. Spent decades as an agnostic as a result. When the High Lama snapped a crying toddler on the side of the head to get him to shut up, then demanded that children be kept out of earshot, 1,000 yards away. Great compassion my butt. Not to mention he got drunk every night while he taught. Not to mention he said Westerners lacked the discernment to judge and choose their own teachers. Was accidentally in a religious cult. I would see how the pastor would treat non-members and members that didn't comply with what he wanted, and I would think, I hope he doesn't start acting this way towards me. He would berate people. Gossip. Expect us to stay at his house until late hours. Forbid us to hang out with non-members. And he even asked me to move in there when I already had my own place. I noticed it was a cult when I told them I was hanging out with an old friend, and they proceeded to ask why was I doing that and that they were my friends. I came to a service that following Sunday and the pastor sees me and says I had a message I was going to preach, but I'm going to preach a different message today. The whole service was pretty much him talking crap about me and making rude jokes. I knew this sermon was about me when he kept referencing the person hanging out with other people and saying it was sinful and of the world. I never felt so embarrassed in my life with everyone laughing at me. I sat that entire service just embarrassed. Once I left, several of the members attempted to contact me, with a few of them trying to go to the movies with me at midnight when they knew dang well the closest movie theater was an hour away, and what movie theater shows movies at midnight? After I stopped going to that church, a few of the members completely stopped talking to me despite us being friends. Still can't believe that happened to me. I saw an ambush intervention re-indoctrination in your future. Glad you stopped going to that church. I was actually in a church that transformed slowly into a cult. They just slowly started doing more and more miracle things and being open more and more days open with encouragement to be there for those days. Tithes became incredibly important and the priest family became more and more important. I left, but I heard some insane things happened after I left. I was lucky as I came from a really complicated low socioeconomic background. When I moved for uni, there wasn't much fight for me. This sounds so much like my mother-in-law's non-denominational evangelical church. I went to a service with her once, and it seemed to me that they were worshipping the pastor and his family at least as much as they were worshipping God. It creeped me all the way out, and I never went again. I used to practice kung fu at what was basically the most McDojo place ever. On top of all the usual money-grabbing bulls, the grandmaster changed his title to something like His Celestial Holiness and started getting his students to travel to the woods to build his temple. Nope. Just left the Jehovah's Witness religion this year. Honestly, what really did it for me was the fact that my entire life all the speeches and sermons started sounding identical, insisting that the end was coming. I was raised as one, so I just thought that it would have happened by now. I talked to an older friend of mine who also used to be in the cult and asked him, "Hey dude, when you were young, did they say the end was coming?" He answered that they've been preaching the same thing since the 60s. I was denied of a regular childhood and they took away my teen years. I vowed when I left that I wouldn't give that cult another day of my life ever again. My mom and her family have been super understanding and still talk to me as if nothing happened, even though they still attend regularly. When I was told I couldn't ask questions, I was 14. All that did was make me ask more questions. I ended up at the public library reading up about cults. This was in the 90s. The library, we've got your back. Had an accident when I was 12 that injured my back. Sitting hurt. I convinced my mother to allow me to walk around during the multi-hour long services in the library overflow room downstairs that had a speaker blaring whatever was going on at the pulpit. In that library with all the original cult publications from 80 plus years previous. No one ever paid any attention to them, but I was a voracious reader. They were into some wackadoo crap at the beginning that totally contradicted the current teachings. Pyramid power. Numerology. I never said anything because it was a closed society and questioning meant total shunning, but from that point on I was aware that it was all garbage and I spent most of my time planning my escape. When I finally publicly called bulls 6 years later, I lost everyone and everything. Life sucked for a while, but 10/10 would do it again. Don't answer the door when Jehovah's Witnesses come knocking, especially if you have children. They're hiding tens of thousands of pedophiles in their ranks. FN weirdo doomsday bastards. I always answer because they often have their child with them. I just look at the kid and say something like, "When you're older you will have the ability to just leave if you want. Don't let anyone tell you that you can't." When I saw the leader pimp slap one of the followers and cut up a piece of holy art. I read that as a leader pimp rather than a pimp slap at first and was a little confused. Mine wasn't a typical definition of a cult, but I realized Jehovah's Witnesses were pretty delusional by about 12-13 years old. Took me a few more years to get out due to my father being an elder and someone who had no problem physically forcing his son to go to meetings and out in service. Door knocking. Sounds like a corny fake scenario, but it took me being tough enough to fight him off. Was asked to leave the house at 17 while still in grade 12. So I did. I had a job and had an older friend to live with. That's when I realized it was, in my opinion, a cult. That you would turn on your son because he didn't believe what you believe. That you would beat your son because he was being bullied at school and couldn't stand door knocking anymore in his own neighborhood, where he encountered classmates either at their homes or as they were riding their bikes down the street on a sunny Saturday morning, with me walking with my dad in a suit and tie with a briefcase full of maniac ravings about living forever. When an assistant youth minister at my family's fundamentalist church, Church of Christ, separatist, who had been struggling to have a child with his wife for several years, was finally able to conceive. He was so happy he wrote a song thanking God for his blessing of a daughter to be. He played it for us on his guitar in the back of his pickup in the parking lot before service began. When the elders of the church heard that he had played an instrument on church grounds, they excommunicated him and ordered him to never return to the property on pain of trespassing. This was a denomination which taught specifically that attendance to church within the denomination was mandatory to enter heaven. Essentially, they'd sentenced a good man to heck for the crime of thanking God for his child. I asked my grandfather why they had done that, and he told me that the church forbade instruments because they were not permitted in the Bible. I pointed out that the harp and lyre were explicitly mentioned in 2 Samuel and Chronicles, and that several of the psalms were specifically composed for the harp, lyre, and trumpet. He replied that there were no instruments in the New Testament, and that the New Testament superseded the Old, so anything not explicitly permitted in it was disallowed in the church. When I responded that by that logic we should not be permitted to wear pants to church, as the New Testament makes no mention of pants, he flew into a rage and did not speak to me for some time. I stopped attending the church the following Sunday. The saddest part of this is that the New Testament establishes the New Covenant. This means that, while the law is still important, religious rules are not the way to heaven. Jesus repeatedly condemns the Pharisees for being more concerned about the letter of the law than having compassion. When I realized I was afraid of doing outside research on the religion, cult, I was raised in, I was afraid I'd be allowing Satan to control my mind. Once I did research it, I realized that for so many years I thought I was thinking for myself, but I was really just being controlled and told what to think and do. And then it further intensified the realization I was in a cult when my whole family turned their back on me and started shunning me because I stopped believing in their nonsense. Three things happened. 1. A person died from suspicious circumstances, loosely tied to the group, and none of the adults would listen to me that he did not commit suicide. 2. I started to meet those back parking lot kids at school who were into free thinking and questioning religion. Most are artists and successful loving parents now. 3. Couple those things with the fact that the youth group weekly Bible study leader thought she could actually see demons and the head youth leader was backing her up on her claims. I was pretty ready to leave when I turned 18. I did not go back. I go to church because my parents are religious and they pay my tuition. But there's one lady that says she was chased by a demon after watching a horror film. I put her and her demon on the church's prayer list. When I worked at Home Depot, the first line of one of the books the owners wrote was "Home Depot is not a cult." Our anti-MLM has some ex-cult stories, since many MLMs operate as cults and or use the same tactics. A handful of people there have been part of religious cults, too. Yeah, the one MLM with branding, sex slaves and Hollywood celebrities was a weird one. Once I was invited to a supposed Christian youth meeting by my cousin. I didn't really want to go but she insisted, so I ended up there. It was held in a small apartment, and when we arrived we were greeted by the group leaders, which seemed like totally normal young people. Afterwards the other members arrived and they turned off all the lights at the apartment. I thought that was a little weird but no big deal. Then they started with the music. They put those Christian rock songs they usually use at normal Christian youth groups but they started dancing like maniacs, jumping everywhere, flailing their arms, and the weirdest of all, laughing uncontrollably. Then, in 1 second, they all threw themselves to ground, got on their knees and started crying like their mother had just been brutally murdered. After this they got up and started dancing and laughing again, as if nothing ever happened. I was seriously creeped out at this point, but this was only the beginning. They started with this weird ritual where they promised to perform any miracle you wanted or needed, as Christ allowed them to do so. A kid said he wanted to get taller and so they put their hands all over him and started murmuring prayers for a while. Then they put him against a wall and they claimed he had at least grown 3 centimeters. He believed them. Like, seriously believed them. Later, they claimed that they could turn water into wine and grabbed a bottle of water, put their hands on top of it and prayed again. The water didn't change at all, but they all drank from it and claimed it tasted like wine and claimed they were getting drunk from it, while laughing hysterically again. Finally the reunion ended and they continued being as normal as they were before, as if nothing had happened. I left and when they tried to contact me again I just ignored them. Dude, that was actually a Rites of Spring show. When I wasn't good enough, it wasn't enough that I showed up, paid money and contributed to the group. There was always this hint of disappointment that I couldn't bring in more people, through subtle hints like, "You can bring other people if you'd like. We'd love to be able to save your loved ones," to, "Why don't you ever bring people in? Your loved ones deserve to be saved," and people who were social and outgoing were described as the most desirable people to invite into the church. My pastor straight out said, "We aren't going for thendlers you see sitting alone at lunch. We need to go for the social kids with groups of friends all around them. It's our goal to save as many people as possible, so we need to go for them." I can't remember an exact moment, but things started to click when I wasn't allowed to go home by myself anymore and my parents refused to have any more involvement, so they tried to make me go live in Georgia with total strangers. I got out not long after. When I realized ever since I was a kid I had been railroaded towards getting married and having more kids in the organization. Everything I was ever taught was how to be a good wife with sewing and quiet journaling and crafts with no encouragement for my dreams of being a scientist. Once when I was 14 I said to a leader that I didn't want kids and wanted to be a scientist. And I remember the exact words, "Well, when you decide you do want to have kids, remember that that's the greatest calling you can have." When I got older I did some research and compared it to the approved resources. I found a lot of lies and cover-ups they taught and found the truth disgusting. My parents were in this religious cult that always asked for crazy amount of donation. It even sent families out to pioneer for the religion. We were one of the family. Then coming to Canada and we had financial immigration issue. The organization immediately distanced us. Only then did we realize this was not what we thought it was. The way they motivated people was like any cult I have heard of. Obligatory, not me, but my friend's grandfather was a farmer growing up. Think 1940s or 50s. It was kind of a remote town. But he would talk to other farmers and buyers when he went down to the market. One day, an acquaintance of his tells him that they're having a meeting with a whole bunch of other farmers and farmhands and that he should come and join. My friend's grandfather, thinking it's some sort of farmers alliance, is like, sure, why not? Friend's grandpa goes to the meeting and is a bit confused when it's not about farming at all. It's a KKK meeting. He has an "oh crap, I'm in a cult" moment. But waits till it's over because he doesn't know what will happen if someone sees him trying to leave. Meeting ends. He goes home. Dude tries to invite him again and friend's grandpa nopes out of there. It was the summer during middle school when a friend of a friend invited us out to a camp that lasted the week. It has so much awesome stuff like paintball, four-wheeling, swimming on the lake. It was right on. Sounded kick-ass. So I went. It was an ultra-religious camp. We had to give our phones up when we got there. First hour of the day was praying. Then 30-minute breakfast followed by another hour of praying. Then 2 hours of alone time where you couldn't go back to your rooms or do anything other than sit and talk to Jesus and God. Then another hour of praying. Then 30-minute lunch. Then 30-minute prayer. Then a good 4-5 hours of free time to do all those activities. Then another hour of prayer. Then 30-minute dinner. Then prayer. Then we got to go back to our rooms to talk to our assigned counselor, who led us in evening prayer. I'm not saying that this place was a cult, but I had my thoughts when they led us on a march to a big fire and made us lay down in a massive field staring at the stars while they chanted prayers over a microphone one night that week. Frick, that place. Jeez. I've been to Jesus camp before, and while it certainly had its religious theme and plenty of discussion on the Bible, it was still a summer camp where you did fun activities the vast majority of the day. What you described sounds like torture. When I realized how dead serious they were about their Nazi bulls. I was part of a cult church when I was invited soon after I started attending school at UF. Since I was looking for a church to attend, this worked out great. I was invited by a real nice guy and started attending every service, getting to know everyone and making great friends. The services seemed to be a bit extreme, a little too fire and brimstone, but I decided to ignore that and focus on what I agree with. I started getting a little uncomfortably when they tried to make me recruit people on the street, but I really felt uneasy when they said I shouldn't hang out with my friends that followed other religions and even family members, because they are not good influences. Despite all of this, I kept going mainly because of the people there. It wasn't until my sociology class did a unit on cults and how they work, being nice and friendly and then trying to separate people from their friends and family so they won't be persuaded to leave. After that I decided to stop attending services, although I stayed in touch with some people. It's a real shame because most of them are born again Christians and don't know that a real church isn't like that. They're great people, just led by the wrong person. For me it was when, after almost a decade of being raised in and working for them, I got fired by them. The reason being I had watched a Chris Rock video, and this was reported by one cult leader's many spies he apparently had in each department. Found this out after a lot of digging once I had become disillusioned. He decided it was proof that I was not pure in Christ and had to be removed from the flock of Christ. The idea that something so innocent as a comedy YouTube could be a grievous sin against God, as he put, struck me as beyond ludicrous and awakened a very cynical part of me, and so the journey of searching for truth began. I think some people aren't commenting because your topic made them realize they should leave Reddit. When the church spent more time talking about how we should bring people out to church than they actually talked about the gospel, I decided it was time to go. When I was told that proceeding in a ceremony and receiving a gift that was a religious rite of passage to adulthood would require me to take upon myself certain sacred obligations, and that I could not know them beforehand, I could either leave then in front of my family or essentially sign a blank check to swear any oath required of me later on. You have been visited by the Inspector Doggo. Comment your confession. If you are new to the channel, you can subscribe. I publish new videos every day. Until then, check another video. Or don't. Either way, have a great day, you magnificent people.